I was resting. I had left him at 5 in the morning, and he called at noon and said he wanted to go to Las Vegas. He had never been there. Could I pick him up somewhere? And I did. From L.A., the flight to Vegas is just under an hour, and flights left every hour of the day, and he was ready. But first he wanted to have a drink on the way to the airport. There was a topless club called the Losers on La Cienega that Jim Morrison frequented. We went into the dimly lit bar where there were two or three dancers working an early shift. It was one of the first establishments of that kind around Beverly Hills. A fairly innocent kind of a show. John ordered a Brandy Alexander and put a couple of quarters in the jukebox. He watched one or two of the girls dance for 15 or 20 minutes. Then they came off stage and wanted to know when the Beatles would get back together again. "Let's get out of here," he said. On the way out of the club, he softly and half-mockingly sang, "We make them paint their face and dance." As we were driving away from there to the airport, he became very quiet. He had been up all night, and it appeared to me that the die had been cast. In a very brief period of time, he got a preview of coming attractions. He had left New York City, the woman he loved, his environment, the Dakota, the intellectual stimulation that yoga brought to his life, his artistry, all the things that had meaning and value, and was now grabbing a quick one at the Losers Club after being up all night drinking, and was on his way to Vegas. It was one of those moments where it was not necessary for him to speak to me. There were a lot of those moments. John needed to shut down from time to time. I always honored his silence. Las Vegas went by in a kind of blur. We weren't there for more than 48 hours. The snapshot I recall is this. We found ourselves walking through the casino like tourists. Late afternoon. John walked over and stared at a slot machine. He was just watching it, not playing. And a blackjack dealer asked me, "Is that John Lennon?" I said, "Yes, yes it is." "Is he just here having fun?" he asked. And I said, "Well, he's just here." John asked me where the roulette table was and whether or not I had any money on me. He didn't. He never seemed to carry any. Of course, if he went over to the credit cage, I'm sure they would have taken care of him, but it was easier to ask me. I told him I had about $500. He said, "Let me show you how to win at roulette." That got my interest. We went over to the roulette table and he said, "Just get 100. John didn't have a great familiarity with money. He would use phrases like "get me 50" or "get me 100. I don't know if he knew if it was dollars or pounds or what it was, because he never touched money. When he spent money, the money was invisible. Even years later, we'd go out to a restaurant with Yoko, and he'd take out his American Express card. When it came to the matter of tipping, he would hand it to me and ask what the tip should be, because he couldn't compute it. It was kind of like going to England for the very first time and getting out of a London cab and the driver telling you what you owe him, and you've got this new currency in your pocket. It always seemed to me that whatever currency was in John's pocket was of a foreign nature to him, and he didn't know what to do with it. And like most well-to-do rock stars, he rarely paid for anything. I was very interested in seeing what his plan was for winning at roulette, and I vaguely recalled that he talked about playing in Hamburg, Germany. He bought 100 $1 chips and said, "Watch this." With great aplomb, he placed a dollar chip on every single number except one. There are 38 numbers on the wheel, and John's theory was that if you put a bet down on every single number except one or two, when the wheel turned, the odds would be in your favor 97 or 98% of the time, so you would eventually win. As soon as John reached the roulette table, the cocktail waitresses were there with Brandy Alexanders and Chardonnay. 35 chips being piled up, shoved in your direction, looks pretty impressive. And one chip, of course, brings an impressive-looking return. After 15 minutes, he resembled Donald Trump, until one of the numbers he didn't bet upon popped up, and the dealer would clear the table of all the chips. Soon he drew a huge crowd and the attendant madness. People were paying enormous attention, dropping hundreds on red or black and odd or even. Some bet with him or covered the numbers he did not play. Pit bosses appeared along with security people, while others wanted him to sign napkins. Word spread quickly through the casino. Dr. Thompson would have included the moment in Fear and Loathing if he had been present. Needless to say, we lost all of my money extremely quickly. What was occurring in Los Angeles was a corruption of optimism, a real sense of loss over his separation from Yoko, and a fear that he might spend an eternity being recalled as the guy who once played with the Beatles, and that terrified him. On more than one occasion, he said that the thought of appearing in Las Vegas with a piano or a guitar, singing Beatles songs, regardless how much they paid him, would be an absolute horror and nightmare that he would never consider. I have often wondered if he might feel differently about that subject today. We were at a place called the Old World Restaurant on the corner of Sunset Boulevard and Larrabee. John liked the wooden floors and darkened alcoves, but on this specific occasion we sat outside on the patio. As we were sitting at a table watching the cars drive by, you couldn't help but smell the fumes. He was unshaven and somewhat unkempt, and appeared to anybody seeing him like a man on the skids. It was our breakfast hour after one of the Phil Spector rock and roll recording sessions, and John was eating scrambled eggs and pancakes. He was talking about Yoko and trying to devise new methods of convincing her to allow him to return. As he was talking, a rather tall, exquisite-looking woman approached the table. She was wearing lots of silver bracelets, a tight black leather miniskirt, and an emerald-green Victorian-like blouse. "I don't want to disturb you," she said. "I just want you to have this. Use it when you're ready." She placed a napkin in his hand and walked away. He opened the napkin, glanced at it, and handed it to me. It was a first name and a phone number. He continued talking about Yoko, and then we got in my car and drove back to Lou Adler's house. It had been a bittersweet evening. The adrenaline rush of those rock and roll sessions was spirited and intense. Phil Spector created sounds that you could not shake. They stayed with you long after the recording sessions. Some of those masterpieces never go away. It was an emotional time, and there was a lot of alcohol and marijuana that accompanied John's reflections and experiences. I've never spoken about them in detail, and I am still reticent to start now. However, as I dropped him off and was preparing to leave the house, he asked if I still had the napkin. I did. "Call her," he said. So I did. And the next day I drove over to pick him up, to take him someplace, and she was there, in a robe, still wearing those bracelets. She said, "I remember you from yesterday at the old world." I walked down the hallway and found John, and he said, "Get rid of her." I politely asked if she needed any vehicular transport to her destination. There was no need, she said. She would find a cab. He was withdrawn for the rest of the day and asked if I had spoken to Mother. It was the beginning of the end of the lost weekend for him because he recognized the obvious. He understood where it was going. He could spend a lifetime collecting phone numbers scribbled on pieces of paper. At age 34, he knew that's how it might be forever. There would be 1,000 amorous women in terry cloth robes waiting around in the morning while he assigned somebody the task to get rid of her. He had already been there. He had never been a bachelor. He married his first wife, Cynthia, because she became pregnant with his child, and that was what a real man did in Liverpool at the time. He virtually abandoned his first son, Julian, to fulfill the destiny of being a beetle traveling the world. The local promoters and record company advance people would stock the hotel rooms with wall-to-wall groupies and women who were extremely accommodating and would not ask for autographs. There had been hundreds of them around the globe, along with all the drugs and drink that the most famous musical group in the history of the world could ask for, without having to ask, and he seldom said no. And finally he screamed out for help with Saved by Yoko. So here he was again, reliving a time that had died years before. He just needed to be reminded of what was never there, and Yoko knew he would see it in time. It didn't take all that long. As soon as he glanced at his reflection and saw the past masquerading as the present, he realized that there could be no future without her, and he had to get home. Not long after that, he appeared at Madison Square Garden, walked on stage unannounced at an Elton John concert, sang 3 songs, and made the building shake. It was his last public concert. After the show, he returned to his dressing room, and Yoko was there with a white gardenia. 10 months later, on October 9, 1975, John's birthday, Sean was born.